Should we jump into the first video?
Yeah,
Yeah.
let's share that.
What have you got for me?
We are going right back to the beginning, guys. Literally, the beginning, the search.
Oh my God, the search.
You look so cute, Ari. You look so young.
I'm a bit nervous to go right back.
Ready?
Yep.
Come on.
I've always wanted to be a pop star, and now it's like a dream come true.
I've always wanted to be a singer.
Really just want to be a pop star.
I've never ever done anything like this before.
This is what I really want to do.
It's a dream come true, really.
I just wanted to do it just for experience, really.
It's just what I wanted to do.
Is my dream has definitely come true.
Autumn 2001, and S Club 7 gave you the chance of a dream come true, the chance to become an S Club Junior. The band were looking for seven talented performers to sing with them at Wembley. CBBC flew all the way to Hollywood to meet them and find out more about it. Thousands of you showed up to the auditions in Manchester, Glasgow, Cardiff and London.
We got up about, say, 6:45. And we got a taxi to the Cardiff University.
I was number 46.
Don't stop moving, find your own way to
it. Just couldn't believe it that I got through the that round. That was even just amazing just to get to perform in front of Nicky Chapman.
There were 40 finalists in total, and the judges had one day to pick just seven. For a grueling 3 hours, everyone danced in front of Nicky and the band, and they really gave it their all.
It could have just thrown a load of names in the air and just picked any.
Have you ever loved and lost somebody? Wish there was a chance to say.
He was just like, he had me like,
ah! Picked our final seven, and we're really happy. But then we came away and we all discussed it that night and the next day and suddenly thought, you know what, there's two more that we absolutely loved and why not throw out the rule book?
When they said that, I couldn't believe it. I just thought, I don't know what I thought. I just couldn't believe it.
Next day, it was time to get down to work.
After Children in Need, we did voice coaching with David and Carrie, so that was like the first time we all sung together properly.
Really hard, isn't it?
Yeah, because you can't like hear yourself on stage.
Like,
but although it's like really loud, really around you, you still can't hear yourself because you hear everyone else's sound.
We're gonna make this real quick.
No more waiting around. This was it.
We really did go back.
Yeah.
So what was the journey like with the search?
What was the journey like? It was weird because I didn't really know much about it to begin with. It was actually a friend of mine that said, oh, do you want to go and audition for this? And I was kind of like, oh, what's this about? And then obviously she kind of filled me in and I was like, okay, that sounds fun. I'll go with you. It's like someone that I just used to kind of like locally that I danced with. So yeah. I went with her and then, yeah, just kind of, it was a bit crazy because I'd never really traveled anywhere for like a big audition before and it was kind of not something I was used to. But yeah, I just kept getting through the rounds and then went to London. I think Cardiff was actually the last week before the finals. So I think it was literally just, I did Cardiff and then I went to London the week after and then did the final and obviously met the Big S Club, which is, again, I think they're the first famous people I've ever kind of been in same room with. So that was a bit overwhelming. But yeah, it was crazy, really. It just, I don't know, it's weird. That, I can't really remember. Well, obviously I can, but I can't. But
no, obviously not watched it back.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, it's just all come flooding back. And I think obviously because they kind of like, that was intertwined with like interviews that we'd done maybe a little bit afterwards. It's just weird seeing like me in my old bedroom talking about it. And obviously like when you're that young, you don't really have any experience in being spoken to as an interview. So I just felt like every single interview of us when we were younger is so bad. Like we don't really say anything. We just giggle and like dodge the question or just kind of, I don't know. It's so embarrassing to watch us speak on camera.
I think most people think like that when you hear yourself on camera, it can be a bit daunting. But I mean, it's crazy to look back and see everything that happened from then and think that was 20 years ago.
Yeah, that's nuts. It's 20 years ago. And there was 9 of us at one point.
So what do you think was the best memory from the start of it? So like when you first got on stage, when you did the tour, the S Club, like...
The best memory was just the fact that like we didn't know it was going to be a band. Basically, like we, at the auditions, there was like even notices on the walls and the like the doors of everywhere saying like, you know, this is not a record contract. It's solely just to like have a one-off performance with S Club 7. And I just find it weird they kept reiterating that, because it's like, I guess you don't really think, you just knew you were going to audition for something at a, you know, that you saw off the TV. And then they were being very specific about what it wasn't. Anyway, then when we obviously went for our first meeting, that's when they were literally like, no, you know, we want you to record music and be a band and you won't just be doing the Wembley date on the tour, you're going to go on the whole tour with the band, with S Club 7. And then they literally played One Step Closer right there and then.
Wow.
And it was like, oh my god, this is our single, like what? Like it was just very, the ball started rolling very quickly. And then obviously hearing that was going to be our first single, and kind of like obviously One Step Closer is quite a, you just kind of knew it was a kind of going to be a bit of a hit. As soon as we heard it. So it wasn't like, I don't know, we just made you even more excited about the whole process. So yeah, I remember being just like very, very, very excited. And just, I think everything at that age was just, you know, all the firsts. Like it was just the first time in a recording studio, the first time in a TV studio, the first, you know, there was just so many firsts that I just think, you know, we were always just on cloud nine.
I mean, it seemed pretty, I think most kids and probably most of us here all dreamed we were you guys. Oh. All did the dance routines.
I mean,
and we were in our bedrooms. Like,
I guess, yeah, I guess we were just, because we were the same age as like what our fans were, but we just kind of all grew up together. And
yeah,
it was a very, the only weird thing about it was that we didn't know that that was what was going on. I guess because there was no social media, and the only kind of like time we kind of knew you were kind of popular, I guess, is when like, you know, maybe people would like hang outside, I don't know, the concerts or the hotels and stuff, but just random, because obviously everyone was still very young. It wasn't like they would go off on their own as kids and follow us around the country, because you just wouldn't do that when you were younger. Like you need your parents and stuff. But yeah, like we didn't have that kind of contact. Obviously we received like fan mail, and there was times where we saw our fans, but it was all very like calculated, whereas now obviously everyone has just got all access to social media.
Yeah, everyone.
Massive difference.
Did it kind of catch you off guard then? Sorry. Did it kind of catch you off guard to see the reception that we've had through Instagram and through promoting what we're doing?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a hard one because, I don't know, it's not like we have like timeless classics of like things that just get played on the radio all the time. So it's not like very remembered, like throughout you kind of, it was very much an era thing of like, you know, you either knew about us and then you kind of stayed with us as a fan or whatever. So, you know, it's great that, you know, we were like a big part of people's childhood. I feel like it's on, I think TikTok has been like some of the very like been quite overwhelming when like some of the videos of like, because people have just stumbled across it unwillingly, knowing that I even was in the band, or I don't know, I think it was someone posted a video and then I like duetted it, and then they, you know, then that kind of blew up, and then it's just weird seeing all the comments of people just talking about it, and I was like, oh my god. And it's now it's weird that I can actually like have a joke and laugh and respond to all these people about the time. So yeah, it's very different, and yeah, it's very overwhelming, but at the same time I'm not like quite realistic in the sense of it just was, we're not, you know, we're not huge great success stars or anything, but like, you know, it's cute, it was a fun time that it's lovely to be remembered and have all these people still kind of like, you know, even wanting to listen to me tonight. Do you know what I mean? It's that's great.
Do you still remember all the dance routines?
Yeah, I wouldn't say all of them, like I can still remember like One Step Closer. As soon as I hear the songs, like, I can kind of like remember little bits. Like I said, when I did that, when I kind of like copied what the video was on TikTok, it kind of all came screaming back to me. But yeah, it's like, we've just performed them so many times that they are still in the book. I mean, they're not like probably perfect, but the majority is still ingrained in there. So especially obviously being a dancer as well, it's kind of like, it doesn't really leave my body.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Do you ever regret doing the glorious I Dream series?
It's a weird one because the truth behind that is like we had the people that were that were in charge, like wrote all of the like LA 7, Miami 7, all those people. It was because it was Simon Fuller's brother. He's like a writer, actor, producer type person, and he kind of like wanted to produce something different. And obviously we couldn't do exactly the same as what S-Top 7 did, because I think it wouldn't be as good. So they obviously went with the musical theatre school thing. And I guess because it wasn't going to be like all about our music, there was going to be other songs written. And then, you know, we weren't all actors and actresses also, because we were quite young and not even had the kind of like training or maturity for that. You know, they drafted obviously other actors in, which is cool, but it was the fact of like, I just think there was also too many writers on that show that kind of, I feel like episodes were just not really linking or making sense. And also the songs were being drafted in after that we'd even finished like the song, like the episodes. Sometimes like songs weren't ready. And we'd have like a demo, or we'd be in Barcelona and we'd know that there's a song, and we were like, well, what's the song? And they're like, we haven't got it yet. And it was just like, we would have like thought about this a bit more, or have a bit more like planning, or because essentially it was High School Musical, and then High School Musical came out the year after and blew up. Like, and it was just like, you've massively missed a trick. But obviously us being young, like it wasn't our series to kind of be like, this is what we want, this is da-da-da-da. Like, you just kind of say yes at that age and you're just grateful to have a TV show. But then it's kind of a bit like, obviously me being a creative now and kind of just working in the industry for so long, I just look back and go, that was handled so badly. Just the fact that we didn't even know who sung what. Like sometimes the choreographer was like, do you want to sing this bit? Do you want to sing that bit? Then we'd mime to someone else's voice and then we'd have to go and record the actual song when we came back to London. So it was almost like you didn't even know what you were going to sound like singing that. So then you kind of had to, when we recorded it, we had to sing it exactly like we kind of mimed it to someone else's voice. It was just very complicated. And I just think it was a bit of a rush job that could have been thought out and done a whole lot better.
Yeah, sounds like utter chaos.
Yeah, but I mean, I don't regret it. I mean, the way I see it is, it's like we had a fun 6 months in Barcelona. The only bad thing about it was, for me, that I was also doing my GCSEs at the time, and my GCSEs were kind of spread out over the course of like 2 or 3 weeks. So they flew me back and forth for each single exam. So I had literally to come over for an exam, finish it, then go back to Barcelona. So I was like revising for my GCSEs, going back to Cornwall, and then I was learning lines for I Dream, coming back to Barcelona. And then sometimes because of like weather or things that had changed in the schedule in I Dream in Barcelona, like they'd kind of, they'd be like, oh, Aaron, we shot this yesterday when you weren't here, which means you now can't be in this scene, that scene, and this scene because of continuity. And I'm like, well, that's what I'm back for those scenes. And they were like, well, sorry. So I did miss out a lot of the show just purely because of the way continuity worked. And obviously, because otherwise I'd just be popping up in random scenes and he'd be like, well, where did Aaron come from? Or like, so I did, like a lot of my lines did go to others or, you know, times when I wasn't there. But it's just, I had to do my exams. Like, and we were very like monitored by the council and making sure we did do our exams. And the thing is, I was the only one that they kept in school. I was like the guinea pig because I was the eldest. It was like, right, whatever Aaron does, we can either see if that works or it doesn't. And it kind of didn't work for me to do my GCSEs with staying with my school. So the four below me, in the year below me, they all kind of got taken out of school and they kind of enrolled in like a online thing where they kind of get all the work sent to them and they just basically take their exams at a examiner center place. I don't know. But yeah, that was the kind of downside for it for me. But at the same time, I kind of like wasn't, I was happy to be in Barcelona.
Yeah, don't blame me.
Kind of piggybacking off of that, do you think I Dream maybe caused the end of S Club 8?
Possibly. It's weird. At the same time, like I remember being out in Barcelona and still like a massive music and pop lover myself. And it was almost like a time where the music industry was changing whilst we were out there. And I kind of was like, I don't know where we're going to go next, to be honest. Like I'd hit 16, which meant I didn't need a chaperone anymore. And I know that the girls were growing up and they wanted to wear like more of their own stuff. But then at the same time, like our fan base was very young. And, you know, there wasn't as much money as there was in the first place. And we were an expensive band to keep. We had chaperones, we had tutors, we had eight of us, that's eight hotel rooms. That's because half of us lived away, they had to buy a house for us in London. And, you know, it was a lot of expenses like compared to other bands. And I just think, you know, I think it was more of a decision of like, I'm not sure this is gonna, you know, it's a bit of a risk to go, right, is this eight gonna grow up and be, I don't know, a successful band for many years to come? Or is it kind of like, you know, the music industry changed, we're not sure where they place, you know, I don't know. It was a weird one because I guess at the time when you say you're doing I Dream, there wasn't really much talks to do music after. So I don't really know. So weird. You look back and go, why didn't you ask these questions? Why didn't you be like, what's going on? Or we were just on this kind of like conveyor belt and just said, yeah, we'll do that. That's next. And then, yeah, it was disappointing the fact of like, you know, I Dream wasn't massive. And then I don't know, that was the end of the, because I didn't really love performing the I Dream stuff. Like I felt it just was a bit embarrassing, like performing the I Dream soundtracks on like Top of the Pop Saturday and whenever we could kind of things. It just people were like, well, who are these other people? And
yeah,
you know, it just kind of, I think it blurred a few lines. But I think that just obviously goes to show that even management and record labels weren't even sure what to do in that situation, probably because of the cost, probably because how do we now do music for these, like, for these guys, because they're all different ages. You know, I would be allowed to go off and do whatever I want. The other ones would have to be still chaperoned. That would probably cause a bit of friction, you know. And then it was going to be a case of the following year, just before we finished, half the band were going to have to do their GCSEs. And that's a massive chunk where they wouldn't have been able to really participate in things, whereas they can get away with losing one and kind of hiding the fact that I was in and out and I kind of, you know, you wouldn't really know if you didn't dissect I Dream fully. But I think the following year would have been a lot to have half the band missing because they're GCSEs. So yeah, I think, yeah, that is probably the reason why. But I still don't really know, if I'm honest. But it was, yeah, that was the kind of the end.
Yeah, I was just wondering, did you guys get along well with the non-S Club Junior cast? Because when we watch the series, it does look to me that, you know, as junior bands, we kind of feel, okay, now is the time for the juniors, and then there's the time for the other cast. So how did it feel at that band?
I think it was weird because it's like from a professional point of view, it's like they were all trained actors, and I think they probably held the storylines or kind of gave more of the acting vibes. So to kind of like have, we'll just never know, because we never know what like a series of just us would have been like, and we would probably have been more of ourselves, and maybe if the storylines were more about us, it would have been more fun, that kind of thing. So I don't know, but because it was about this musical theatre school, and you know, there was other actors, you know, I think it was a safety net for us really, so that we didn't look too bad. But in terms of us getting along, we kind of just loved having more people to kind of like hang out with. Like, you know, we only had us eight. We were so used to working with adults, and we were away from our friends from home. So for us, it was kind of like, yeah, jump on, like, let's make the group bigger, and obviously then have a massive, what felt like a holiday in Barcelona. So, you know, it was nice, especially for me, like as an older one, I kind of hung out with them a lot more than the rest of the band in Barcelona, like I said, because I was allowed to be on my own, which was nice for me. And also Lorna, who played Natalie, she actually auditioned for the band. And she was in the beat, because basically that day of the final, there was like 40 of us, and then we got put down to 14, and they had like an A team and a B team. And then me and Hannah got brought up from the B team. But Lorna was in that B team, and she kind of like stayed in contact with our management company, and they kept her for I Dream. But I think Lorna didn't make the band purely because she was slightly older. She's an amazing voice. She would have been great in the band, but she just wasn't, I don't think she looked right. She was a year older than me, and just had that, she was very mature compared to the other girls. So but going back to our relationships, it was, I really enjoyed it, we all did, although it probably doesn't look like it on camera in some of the episodes, but generally we had a great time, to be honest. It was fun.
So during when y'all were filming I Dream, there was a rumor that came out, it was like that y'all had a song that was about to be released called Involved, and it just exploded outside the fandom into like legitimate music sources saying, oh, it was going to be released in June or July. So I was kind of like wondering, like, maybe like y'all know about the song, the rumor.
Yeah, so Involved, it kind of like, I've never heard, I'm literally trying to rack my mind, because obviously it's not like we were just always in the studio and we just recorded loads and loads and loads and just some got forgotten about, because like I said, for us to record a song, all eight of us would go to the studio, we then have to do our schoolwork all day long, and then the producers would pick us out one by one to then do our recording. So I can kind of remember like every song that we did. Involved just doesn't ring a bell. So I don't know where that rumor came from. I don't think there's like anything from either I Dream era that we kind of recorded that didn't make it either.
Juniors are just about to release their first single, and they've been busy letting everyone know about it. And they've been on location shooting their first video. So it's back to school, but not for lessons.
I never thought I was going to make a pop video, but now it's so good.
The video's set in a classroom, but it's no ordinary lesson. When the music begins, things start to happen. Nikki takes a lesson on the set from Aaron.
There's a disco ball, skeletons, uh-huh, which I look at, and they all start dancing.
Is that your, that's your key, is it?
Yeah,
like,
and then
disco scene.
All the blinds come down,
uh-huh,
and then it, like, the whole thing transforms.
The juniors are used to filming, but getting all the right shots takes a long time. So it's out of uniform and into their dancing gear.
Okay, roll the track.
Finally, the bit everyone's been waiting for, and the juniors hit the dance floor. For the first time all day, nobody's feeling cold. The filming's done, but they'll have to wait before they get to see the video. More of that later. The video's finally ready, and the juniors can't wait to see it.
That was a very cold day. Very cold.
You look very embarrassing, young Aaron.
I know, because I just was like, I don't know, because I just hate the way I conducted myself as a kid. Like, I just, like, I just was, I don't know, just not really, just didn't really have anything to offer. Just kind of like, I just stating the obvious, and I hate that. I was like, where's your manners?
You're very young.
True, I just need to remember that. But I don't know, it's just like when you look back at like old photos of yourself, you cringe, and I guess that's what's happening a little bit now.
How was it like filming the video? Like, how did that feel?
Yeah, it was like dream come true, pinch myself moment. Because I like, even before the band, I was always like, I really want to be a pop star. I just want to be a pop star. And it, like, even though like that's like every kid's dream to say that, I don't know, I was like determined, and it was, I'd annoy everyone about it, like to the point where like people at school just be like, oh my God, like shut up kind of vibe. So for me, I was like, I couldn't believe it. And yeah. And I feel like also like I was quite like into it in the sense of like, I love the drama. Like I love the fact that it was icy conditions and like, you know, but a lot of the girls would be like, oh, I can't do it, it's cold. I was like, yeah, but it's like, I love the hard work that goes into it. And like, it's all the kind of like behind the scenes stuff that like you have to go through to make it and to achieve things. Like, but that's the thing, is because it was always in my mindset to be a performer. So, you know, whereas I think some of the other guys in the band, they entered the competition and just got lucky kind of vibe. Obviously they're very talented, but I don't think it was in their mindset to make that a career move. Cause obviously who knows what they're going to be when they're that age. But no, I definitely loved everything about it. And you know, it was just, you know, thinking about all those people there filming this thing like for you is like, is awesome. Yeah, it's weird because I just remember like, I felt like it was a very big, it was a rush to get us out into the world, which is why I feel like I can remember more later on stuff, purely just because One Step Closer was like, record the first four songs, rehearse, tour, vocal coaching, get that video in here. And it was just, then we were on tour, like, so we went on tour straight away, so that when we came off tour, it was like straight into promotion for One Step Closer. So everything prior to that is a bit of a blur because it was just so manic. But yeah.
You just build on the momentum of the show probably, that yeah. People didn't lose interest.
But that day was very special. It was very, very fun. And then I guess like, it's weird because you kind of get used to it and you kind of know what's involved in making a music video. So you kind of get a bit more confident. Because you're used to doing like just singing and dancing as a group, but it's like all the little solo bits and kind of like when you have to do things on your own. And yeah, that was kind of like a learning curve, which was fun.
What do you think the best video was to film?
Ooh, I mean, it's weird because I don't like them both, either of them, but Puppy Love and Automatic High were the best to film. Obviously,
but Fall No More.
Huh?
Fall No More.
No, because that was at, I mean, yeah.
It was probably cold, I imagine. Again, by the way, I'm from Portsmouth.
It was cold.
Last word,
yeah, we filmed Fall No More in Portsmouth and we did it on the day off of tour. Which again is like, it's a lot knowing that like we had to like rehearse for the music video version of the song as well as like knowing what we're doing on the stage as well, because obviously it was different. I remember just waking up in like a hotel and it was very misty the morning we woke up, and it was like, oh God, like this isn't great for the video, and you know, we're not sure what rides we can use because obviously we can't see like the roller coaster, and then that kind of drama. And it was a one day shoot and it was cramming a lot in. And it was kind of hard to dance in a small, tight space
with
dodgems going around us, because the dodgem kind of areas aren't that big, and then you've got eight of us kind of always changing positions, and then like just random extras going around and around and around, and it's like if you're on the end, you're getting your ankle clipped. But no, I guess that was fun. And then obviously the sun did come out, and then we got some amazing shots on the roller coaster at the end, which is pretty cool. But yeah, I don't know why. I think it's because it was rushed and it was all in the day and it wasn't that pleasant. And it's amazing what they can do with videos to make them look better than they actually are, because you wouldn't think we were in Portsmouth on a very cold, misty day. But no, automatic hype was great because obviously we got to go abroad and it was just very like fun in the sun. And we got to like do all the little bits, like me and Jay got to go go-karting and like do stuff. The only thing that went wrong with that shoot was we had to do the choreography a lot of times in like that triangle of like sand with like lots of people around us. And we must have started shooting about, I don't know, 9:10, and they were literally like, guys, we started performing, and then they were like, we were all complaining about dancing in the sand and our flip-flops, and we were like, please, it's so hard, can we not just be barefoot? Like you wouldn't dance in flip-flops anyway in the sand. And they were kind of like, well, that means we're gonna have to film it again, because then we can't use what we've already taken in your flip-flops. We were like, oh, it's fine, can we just do it, because obviously we were. And then, anyway, the regret of that is the sun came up and up and up, and by midday it had heated the sand. They heated the sand up to the point where to dance on the sand was literally scalding our feet. And then like obviously everyone else was like, I bet you wish you danced and you flip now, don't you? So that was some automatic high drama for the dancing in the sand flip-flops situation. But other than that, it was really fun. And then Puppy Love, just because it was filmed in Nebworth House or Castle, I don't know, wherever Robbie Williams did that big concert. Is it Nebworth House or Castle? Anyway, but they basically just fake snowed everywhere, and we just got to basically play in the snow all day in really nice, warm, comfy clothes. But at the same time, like I did miss like the lack of dancing and kind of like upbeat tempo vibes in that. But no, I actually really enjoyed New Direction, just purely because I loved the song. I liked the set, was really cool of like kind of, it just had a, I don't know. I just felt like we were growing up a little bit then, and it was kind of nice. But then we had to do a whole day on a green screen, which was kind of a bit tedious. It was basically like a big plank of wood. Not wood, yeah, big like plank of wood. It was big to hold eight of us. And it was on what I can describe as like a giant beanbag. And then there was literally people either end, like just doing this, like tilting us from side to side. And we just basically did that all day. And they just kept changing up the positions and kept changing the camera angle. So one day was like performance. The other day was like beanbag sway, left and right day. And that was quite tedious.
I imagine that was a bit boring.
Yeah. But I was like, you know, just grateful to be doing music videos. So they're all fun, yeah, in their own little special way.
Anyone have any questions about the music videos or anything they'd like to know about any of them?
Yes, Danny.
Yes, I do.
Oh, Samantha.
Oh, sorry.
You go first.
Oh, thank you. Did you take any mementos or keepsakes from any of the videos that you shot?
Kind of. I still wear to this day, no word of a lie, my Timberland boots and my DKNY coat from Puppy Love video. And I don't know how I managed to keep the Timberlands the way they do. They must have been huge for me on the day, but we were always in a weird, all of our clothes in the band, we were like slightly too old for like Gap Kids and Kids H&M, but we were too old for like, I don't know, like your Topshops and stuff. So it was always a bit like, we were always kind of, but they obviously wanted to make us look not older, but I just think obviously adult clothes, there's more variety. So they kind of, we were always slightly in drowning stuff. Well, I was always in drowning stuff. I'm trying to find a recent video, a picture on my Instagram that I've got the coat and the Timberlands on. I wear the Timberlands all the time, especially in the winter. But no, I do. They're my two favourite items, actually, because and I've kept them. I think that's the only thing. I think my mum has got like the denim stuff in the loft, the classic denim jacket. But I think that's the only thing I've really got from the band days. There was another thing, for the Automatic High video, we got given Kipling suitcases. I don't know if you've ever heard Kipling. It's like a brand of bag, I guess. And each bag comes with like a monkey. That's like their signature thing. And we all were gifted those for, I don't know if we were given them to take all of our stuff over with, but then they were also used in the video when we kind of came out from the airport. The fake airport. It was like an office, by the way. They just put a sign saying airport. But on the way back, we got all of our cases off the luggage at Heathrow, and all of our little monkeys have been stolen. Literally all of them. I know, so that was quite a sad day. But yeah, I think I've probably still got the case somewhere. Still got the case. But yeah, that's the only thing I can really think of. I mean, I definitely thought I'd have my... Oh my God, can you just go and get it? Look, I'll show you. Like, I think it's a bit short on the sleeves, but this is definitely the puppy love that I wore. I literally love it. But the thing is, because I can wear it now, like, you would never know that I wore this all those years ago.
You wouldn't know.
It is a little bit short on the sleeve, I'll give you that. But I can't say goodbye to it because it's just like so comfy inside. And I just think it's still kind of like, I can get away with wearing it.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, that's like my favorite possession from the band days. I can kind of like wear, obviously I'm not going to wear my denim jacket with a sparkly S-Dub Junior logo. Yeah, there you go.
That one.
Yes, I wore it on my birthday. I knew it was on my Instagram. I just couldn't find it. So yeah, that's my memorabilia. Sorry, Danny, I've kind of like, you had a question as well, didn't you?
Did you have a video that you honestly didn't like filming at all?
Honestly didn't like. Not really, you know, like... I think it was always like the excitement, because you knew that the video was always going to be like a new chapter. The one that I didn't love, but the one that I was a bit nervous about was the Sundown video. I went home for like the weekend and it was boiling hot weather. I remember just being on the beach like all weekend, and I burnt my face basically. And the day of the video shoot, my forehead was basically falling off. Like, it was just flaking. And I was like, this is awful. Like, I don't know. This is just the worst thing that could happen. And I was just caked in makeup, or like kind of like a really sticky kind of like thick something to kind of like just keep whatever skin was left to my forehead. But I was just so mortified about it. And it just made me feel really uncomfortable. And that was what, like, although we had like the dance routine, it was on a green screen, but there was definitely like all of our solo shots when we're on a revolver. So we kind of stood on a revolver. So like when we're singing, that's why we're kind of like turning. So we just kept going round and round and round. I knew the camera was on me and I was just like, oh my God, my face is just like falling. And obviously like when you're sunburned as well, you don't feel like, everything's just uncomfortable. And when I'm singing, I can even feel like my facial expressions making my face hurt because it's making me like my wrinkles move and stuff. And I was like, oh, this is awful. But that's really the only thing that I can think of really about a video that I didn't really enjoy. Yeah. I mean, it's not even that bad, but I'm just trying to think of something interesting to say.
It feels bad as a teenager.
Pardon?
It probably felt bad as a teenager.
Yeah, I think it was that. And I feel like, because we were definitely getting to that age where we cared a little bit more about what we looked like. Because I can remember the second album, like the photo shoots and like that, everyone was a bit more like, I'm not wearing that, or I can't, I, everyone had more of a thing about it. So yeah, that was a, oh my God, no, it was also, it was the video, but also on this video, the day we did the video shoot, we were taking, we were doing our album cover for Sundown. And I was worried about that then as well, because it was, they just like, because the thing is, you can do back in the day when you did like, obviously when say one person was filming their solo video shots for Sundown, someone was like outside doing their solo photo shoot for the album or something. So it's kind of like, you just didn't stop. And then, or then someone somewhere else was shooting like their dance pose that was in every single cover to learn the routine. Like there was just always something to do back then. But yeah, no, that was fun.
There is a question.
I feel like tired.
Pardon, what was the question?
I feel like tired. Like you just wanted a break or.
I never feel tired. Not, you'd think so. Like, I mean, yeah, there were times we were tired, but it's just that kind of like adrenaline that kids have that like, they just never shut up or kind of like, and again, just always loved it. Like, you know, if we were getting up early, it was always to do something exciting. I'd only be tired during school because I think like when I had to do my schoolwork, but just mentally I was like sat down still and I knew that I had to get through it. And that would just, for me, switch off because I didn't have much interest in that side of things at the time. So yeah, that was when I felt tired. And then we just used to have like our 2 days off a week, and then that would just kind of like catch up on that's the thing as well, we always had 2 days off a week. That's why when we did work it was so crammed, because by law we had to have 2 days off a week, so we could always chill then.
That's good.
Yeah, there is a question from Lucas. He says he's too shy to come on and ask.
That's all right.
He says, with the likes of Steps, Spice Girls, etc. doing comebacks, do you feel there is a place for S Club 8 to do a comeback?
I don't know, only because like I think I've always said I would just do it for the fun. I probably wouldn't do it to gain anything out of it, like more music or whatever. I'd probably just do it to just like be with those guys again and just maybe sing a song and just kind of have like, just have a little flashback memory. Like, but it's that thing of like I said at the beginning, where like we're just a certain era. Like our songs don't get like, you know, Steps and Spice Girls and, you know, S Club 7, they've got those classics that do come up on the radio here, there and everywhere. But like, I don't think we're as memorable as them in some way. I know there's a lot of people that would love to see us back, but I don't know. It's just when you think about that, you know, would we actually sell out a show, or would we actually do anything on TV that would be worth kind of, you know, but I guess obviously with having Frankie Michelle, who have done obviously so well on the Saturdays as well, they have kind of, they would put a lot of, the viewers in, but then at the same time it's kind of like, I don't know, would they want to go back to the Saturdays, would they want to do the juniors, or I don't know. I honestly don't know. I've never really spoken about it. They've both got a lot going on, but yeah, I've always said like we should just definitely do like a drink or a dinner somewhere and then just see what happens, or you know, maybe there is, or you know, make it something for charity. I always think for something for charity, it just means that you're not doing it for like money or to gain anything from it. And I just think it would be nice to do something, obviously to raise money for whoever, but like, I don't know, I would be up for it. It's just that it's a lot. It's just eight of us. It's a lot of voices and a lot of, I don't know. And we've all very got different experiences in the band. Like I generally loved it all. What I wanted to do, it was my stepping stone into coming to London and making a career out of it. So I've kind of always had that mind, whereas I think, you know, some others may have felt different from different people in the band or their journeys or what they do now. So, you know, some people look back and just want to forget about it kind of thing, because it's just something that they did, but maybe it didn't really, it's affected them what they do now. I don't know. I haven't really dived into it, but I probably know that not everyone feels the same way about me. Like the way I'm telling stories and I can remember everything, people have definitely just blocked it out and probably don't remember as much as I do. But I think that shows that I've got the memories because I generally did enjoy every second.
Yeah. I mean, Frankie said never say never.
She did. She's definitely coming more around. She's definitely saying a little bit more than she usually does. And she does repost things. And But I generally, probably because, you know, probably with the Saturdays, because that's probably too fresh with for the girls. And I think whereas, because S Club Juniors has been so long, it's there's not even any kind of, there wouldn't really be much to kind of, there's no politics there because it's so long ago and we don't really have much with each other. It would just be a case of just getting, organising it, I guess.
It's quite cool to have an episode with everyone. Like all 8 of you in an episode like this.
Yeah.
But trying to arrange it is a different thing. All 8 people, kids.
Yeah. I mean, probably just to do that on our own would be a mission, but I don't know. I definitely like to organise like a drink or a dinner to start with.
Yeah. Get the drinks from you guys and then,
yeah.
And then make decisions from there.
Absolutely.
Shall I play the next video?
Oh my God, how many videos are there?
Yeah.
This is the last one.
Okay. Ah.
That was a bit loud, wasn't it? Sorry about that.
Having a little party. Oh my God, there's so much that I haven't seen that video in ages. And there's so much that I didn't even realize there's other people in that video until now. It's like, I didn't realize that behind us, there's like other people doing things. Well, so there's the ladder at the beginning that should have been taken out. There's like lol, me, Jay, and Rochelle like really pretending that that's really heavy. I remember we always used to laugh at, I think it was when we do that in that, obviously like that, when we all come out of behind Frankie, like somebody, because all the girls were like full of bangles. Obviously we just went to hold it. Someone like plays with their bangles. I think it's Stacey, and it annoys me because, like, obviously being like OCD choreographer person, I was like, no, you messed up the shot. But and what's the thing is, like, obviously sometimes video directors or like the people that edit, they don't see these things. And I just remember that really annoying me. And I kind of used to be like bully her about it all the time. And then what else I can say? Oh yeah, I can sense as well when like me, Calvin, and Jay have had enough of being on that beanbag and we just start messing around, which we did. So there's a lot of like shots of us just giggling. But I actually do enjoy that because I felt like we knew it was definitely an older sound. It was definitely cool. I don't know why we went Bollywood, but we did. I don't think it was too out of place for the video. I just think it was just a bit, I don't think we needed to carry it on for like every single performance afterwards, because when you take it out of context and you're suddenly on Top of the Pops and you're like in full sari and everything, and it's not really anything to do to a nod to that culture, I thought that was slightly odd. But, you know, I guess they'd spent all their money on those clothes, so we've got to reuse them. But yeah, no, I even listen to the song now, I do, like, I think it's definitely my favorite just because I think it's an older song. I think it's not as... Yeah, I think I just got good memories about that one.
One of the questions we got on Instagram was, yeah, what song would you have liked to have been a single that wasn't?
Ooh. Oh God, I need to like look at them to know that. Okay, I'll give you one from each album. I'd say, okay, so Together, a single that wasn't, I thought personally, You Are The One should have been Where Puppy Love Was, because it sounds Christmassy. It's, the video concept would have still fit with it. But I actually think You Are The One is a very beautiful song. Like when it gets to the end and the choir's going and then you've got like, it slowly, like the music fades out and we're all singing. Like, I think that's like, that didn't get the love I thought it would. Like, I felt like that was like an S Club 7 Have You Ever Never Had a Dream Come True type song, which I felt like would have been great. I did not know why we did Puppy Love. I definitely think that would have been a good single to replace that, although I just know me, I'd get bored performing a ballad. So probably I quite liked Feel the Beat, to be fair. I always kind of, and I was gutted that we didn't perform that on tour. I was always sad about that. Anytime Anywhere kind of got a bit boring for me. I think it was one of our like early on ones, and we just always used to rinse it. So I'd definitely say Feel the Beat, but I definitely think You Are the One is a good. Together wasn't really a single, although we did perform that a lot, you know. We performed Together. I think because the album was called Together, we performed that a few times, but I definitely think You Are the One should have been in instead of Puppy Love. And then the other one, Sundown album, I'd probably say it's weird. There's a lot of love for Rush. I don't know if it would have worked, how it would have been for a single for us. But there, that it's weird because on that's like one of the top played in of S-Club 8 for some reason, Rush. But I'd probably say I Just Came to Dance again because it's just like a dancey, poppy kind of fun one. But Rush seemed to have got a lot of love. And what's funny is like
because of the B-side as well.
Oh yeah.
One Call No More.
I didn't know that. Okay, maybe that's why. But what's funny is I actually do sing a lot in Rush, because I laughed at my TikTok because I just think it's funny how like my voice hadn't like developed yet, and I could sing quite high, which is why a lot of people just assumed it was the girls that could sing. Because I remember being in when we heard that song back, and everyone was like, "Who is singing like the main Feel the Rush, like the bit that like obviously it's very like." Edited or whatever, but I was like, oh my god guys, it's me, I remember doing that in the studio, and I'm like, that's you, and I was like, yeah, because the girls were like, I didn't record that. So it's quite funny that the majority of like Rush, the chorus and that whole thing is me. So I guess I did love it because I felt like I'd contributed a lot to the Rush song. But yeah, I'd say them too.
Justice for Rush.
So going back to tours, which tour do you think was better? Was there much difference between the two, other than obviously doing more songs on S Club United? How were they?
I guess like S Club United was big because we were essentially like, it was our tour as well. Like we had people that supported us, and then, you know, we were sharing it at S Club 7. Whereas I feel like before we just did our four songs and we were a support act. So it was definitely nice having... you know, and we did a lot, like we performed, you know, it was fun to perform pretty much all of our first album, and then we got to do
Four No More and Sundown, I believe.
Four No More and Sundown, and it was exciting because that's like no one had heard them yet, because it was, I don't know, like before you perform in songs that, you know, people have never even heard of, which is very rare now. You don't ever get people performing a song and people being like, oh my god, this is the exclusive performance. It's just like it was a bit backwards back then, but I used to love doing that. We did like Once That Closer had a dance break, which is actually, if you're a big NSYNC fan, it's actually the dance break. It's the dance break to NSYNC's Pop. I don't know if you probably haven't heard it, but, and obviously there's no footage of us doing Once That Closer. Can you hear it? Okay, so when it went into like, it's actually a bit of an extended version, but this is before it goes into the dance break. And then it just kind of like. So yeah, if you know the NSYNC Pop, it's pretty much just that. And instead of going Dirty Pop, it just says one step instead. So don't know who cleverly mixed that in, but yeah.
So did anyone here go to the S Club United tour?
Did anybody what?
Go to the tour, S Club United.
Oh, sorry. I've been out of these guys.
I think you were there.
Oh my God, I remember the scarves.
Wow.
The scarves.
I've got the programme, that's it.
I think my mum's got the little teddy bears. We had little teddy bears.
I didn't actually go to the tour. I was so young at that time, but I bought the ticket to it. And then my mum didn't allow me to fly all the way from Hong Kong to attend the tour. So I later on bought this scarf to just to remind myself what I've missed.
So
please get back together so I can finally get a taste of the journey.
Oh, bless you.
Do you ever go back and like watch the little music videos?
Not really. Like I said, I've never watched New Direction in full like that. I mean, I've taken bits for like showreel stuff or like little bits I've edited, but I don't think I've ever really watched them all. I've just kind of skipped. But no, it's nice to look back. And also because obviously, again, the time, it's not like our music videos are in HD quality online. So yeah, it's not something that kind of can be easily. But I think I've even got every video on VHS because we always used to get given it. So I've definitely got them on. I definitely have got them all on VHS.
Well, we've got One Step Closer and Automatic High in HD on our YouTube, haven't we?
Yeah, mm-hmm. I don't know how to get the others.
Literally. Right, we have got a little quiz.
Fun.
Mainly test Aaron's knowledge, but the rest of you can take part as well if you like.
Oh my God, this is going to put me on
the spot. There's 8 questions.
Yeah.
So first one. Which 3 songs reached number 2 in the chart?
Our first 3. One Step Closer, Automatic High, and New Direction.
Yeah. Which junior share the same birthday but 1 year apart?
Oh, I do this wrong every time. I think it's Daisy and Hannah. Yeah. Jay throws me off because Jay is very close.
He's October.
Oh, and then November. Yeah, I just knew Jay was around. He's not that far off Daisy because it was always them two were close. I know they were like a month apart. I wasn't sure if like Daisy shared, I mean Hannah shared it with Jay, but no, I went with my gut instinct. That was right.
Actually, one of these we've already discussed, so we won't go into that one. Which single spent 11 weeks in the UK top 75 of the chart?
I'm guessing One Step Closer, just purely because that's a long time.
Which 4 songs did you guys perform on the S Club 7 tour when you were a support act?
One Step Closer, Automatic High, Anytime, Anywhere, and Together.
You also did an a cappella, I think.
Yeah.
Something like saying who you guys were.
Yeah, it was very cheesy and very... I don't know if we actually did do that in the end. I think it may have got cut.
Maybe it was just on the search when it was filming.
It was in the rehearsals, but I do remember them being a bit like, I don't know. I just think because we hadn't been together that long, we didn't have the in-ears. It was pretty much just 8 kids shouting out harmonies and hoping for the best. And I just know that they were just trying to like let us down nicely, but it probably sounded awful, if I'm honest.
Which album reached the highest chart position?
Together, I think it got to number 5.
I think it was higher. No, yeah, it was 5. I've done a lot of fact searching, obviously. What was the name of the TV shows that you were a part of? You should know this, it's kind of been in today.
Oh. Well, is it either S Club Search or I Dream, right? I don't know what if.
No, there's reality shows. So what you guys did at the start.
Oh,
So the search and.
The search and. oh, they made like two like kind of specials. It was even called like Reach for the Stars or like Bringing the House Down or something.
That was part of the search.
Oh, was there something else we were part of?
You had 7 episodes of the story.
The story.
So there were 7 episodes of that. And you also did a summer special as well.
Oh, the summer special. Yeah, we did like, again, our singles.
Like Automatic High, New Direction.
Anytime, Anywhere.
Yeah.
Once it closer. Yes, I forgot about the summer special.
The last one, I'm not sure if you will know, because well, someone asked you guys the other day if anyone ever covered your singles.
The American Juniors.
Yeah.
I don't know.
They covered 3 songs they did.
Oh, wow.
And there was a rather famous person that's actually well known now who was in American Juniors.
Really?
Pretty Little Liars, Lucy Hale.
No way. I've actually never seen I've never seen Pretty Little Liars.
Haven't you?
No. But that, wow. I do remember hearing their song and being like, why are they singing our song? Because basically they
a whole thing out there as well. Like,
yeah, American Juniors. Like, they kind of like, they had to sing on live TV and get voted in and out, which I'd hate to have done that. At least ours was like a non-pressure audition. It just kind of was all fun. Whereas that, the Americans make it scary. Like, and obviously because we had the, that's no offense to the Americans in this room. I just meant like, obviously like they're bigger and better and they kind of like, I would hate to have been a kid performing live on TV and getting voted off by the audience. Because I would have got voted off if I didn't get in the band. But no, I know they sang Once It Closer, possibly Sundown.
Sundown. I think You Are the one of them sang on one of the live shows as well.
Oh, interesting. I mean, it's very, I guess because they've got rights to the songs and it's the same management. Simon Fuller did it over there because he was back and forth to America with American Idol. So yeah, it was weird that there was actually plans for us to go over and be a part of that show. But it was pretty much impossible to get 8 of us working visas as kids without our parents to America. So that was always a struggle for us. It took a lot to get us to even to Spain.
Wow.
Yeah.
We would have loved to have you here in America. That's so fun.
I know. I would have loved to have gone. My dream is to work in America. It's just not that easy.
If y'all had come to America, y'all would have released your music here and it would have been a lot more acceptable here in America.
Yeah, I wish we did. Yeah. It's honestly because of the licensing. We had to have the license and they had to, like, people had to go, like, our management had to go into a court and stand up and say what they were doing. It was very, at the time, complicated. And yeah, I think it was just probably not worth what it was in the end. But no, it's a shame. Definitely a shame because I would love to have done that. I mean, I think it's crazy that even our musical is known throughout the world in different places. That, considering we only did the UK, but I generally think our ages and our mass of being 8 definitely let us down. Because obviously, I know that say if there was like 1 or 2, 3, you know, you could probably have your parents, or you know, it's easy to manageable, and you could probably take them around. But 8 is a lot of work.
And 8 lots of parents, that would have been a bit crazy.
Yeah, and of course, like, everyone's parents are different. They've all got their, you know, what they want, what's best for their kid. And, you know, there's always that as well. I'd hate to have been my parents in the parents' meetings. God knows what they talk about, but it must have been stressful.
I can imagine, especially letting you guys go. Like, as a parent, I couldn't imagine how hard that was for them.
Yeah.
But also, they couldn't have said no because you would have probably hated them.
Yeah, I think they were put in a very difficult position, to be honest. And yeah, they didn't really have much say. They just kind of had to go on, just support, really. But yeah, I left home at 13 and I literally haven't been back since to live, or, you know, just haven't been back in the house to kind of. So it's been a long time since I've not lived with my parents.
Also, I know you did choreograph Eugenia.
Yeah.
How did you find that? Obviously, that's something you've done more recently.
Choreography is something I've always wanted to get into. It's kind of one of those things where it's hard to be a choreographer and be a dancer. Like, you kind of, the different, like, the people that you work with kind of need to know what you're doing if you want to be working as a dancer or a choreographer. So I've always kind of struggled to do both because it's been hard, but obviously I've kind of just wanted to live out my dance career. But when the opportunity came up to do the musical, I just loved it. I love the music, which is written by Ben from A1, another little pop
thing. Yeah, I know.
And when we kind of met and spoke about it, it was great because we were both from like the same background of like being in pop bands, loving everything about it, still wanting to be in the industry some way or another. And we've kind of, you know, he's gone into songwriting and I've done the creative side, and then, you know, to kind of get in his mind and to kind of once, because I actually was like maybe choreographing it with like possibly another person, and then once he saw what I'd done, everyone just kind of was like, no, we want you. It's exactly what I kind of saw when I wrote the music, which is always a very big compliment from coming from a writer. I just hope it comes back soon and we can get the Eugenius thing going. The only struggle we've had is the fact that they're changing producers and they've had to wait for a contract to be up to kind of depart ways with them and then get with a new producer, which I think is in the process, but obviously the pandemic has not left, you know, much planning being able to have. So, you know, it's been okay, but fingers crossed that does come off, because I definitely loved it. And I'd love to do other things as well, musicals wise, because I just think it's nice to work on a project for a long time and then kind of watch it run, let it do its thing. But yeah.
Any last questions, guys? Anyone else want to ask any questions?
I have one.
Yes.
Who is the most famous person that you've worked with?
I've worked with?
Yeah.
Probably Taylor Swift.
Ooh.
I danced with her when she sang Never Getting Back Together. Is that one of her songs?
Yeah.
And then I did Shake It Off with her as well.
It's amazing. What was she like?
Just really nice, actually. Like, she's probably one of the most professional people I've ever worked with as an artist, because I'm just used to, obviously being a dancer, I'm just used to kind of like being in the rehearsal room, and then like when the artist comes in, it's usually like a time where we can like relax, and it takes a while for the artist to kind of like learn the choreography and learn what their show is about.
Yeah.
But with Taylor, like, she came straight in and then basically she knew exactly what she was doing, and she performed it and then let us go home early. So it was like,
oh,
what are you doing?
Bonus.
So yeah, no, she was probably the most professional, and you know, and my opening position was my head was over her face. Like, she was on a dancer's back, and then I started over her face. And then when the music started, I like basically revealed her from like the camera. So I just remember, like, when it was first places, it was just always like, oh my God. Because I was just looking directly down into her face. Yeah, it's a real moment.
I have a question.
Yes.
What's the best piece of advice that a music artist has ever given you?
Oh, that's a good one. SP, probably I'm just trying to think. It was, I guess, advice. I mean, there's always like the cheesy kind of like, you know, never give up on a dream and always kind of like aim high or that kind of stuff. Like, one of the times where I've been given, do you say from a music artist?
Yeah, like just in general.
Yeah, it was actually, I feel bad, it's a bit eggy name dropping, but I was lucky enough to be with Justin Timberlake, and we were talking about just dance in general. And like, he was so into the conversation. I was just like in awe of him telling me about it. And, you know, he had his phone up and he was showing me like all these old dance routines that he was like, this is what you need to do. Like, this is like, imagine this with that, and like, you know, what you could do to this. And I just felt like it was so inspiring to like know that there's other people out there that like me, or like someone as amazing as him, like is inspired by things of the past and then making it unique. Because I feel like I know what I like as a creator, or like in dance and stuff, and I like take a lot of my influences from back then, but obviously I wouldn't want to just copy it. I'd want to make it my own, unique, but I love getting inspiration from then and just kind of like molding it into what works now. I just think having him, someone that I look up to, telling me that information, I just was like in awe. I just will never forget like that. And I always think about those times, like how he kind of inspired me to kind of choreograph. So.
We will post on our page how much we've raised, obviously, for the mix, which was Aaron's charity that we've chosen. And I believe Jay's tickets are on sale now.
They are.
They were due to go on sale at 8:30. That'll be quite exciting.
That's fun.
But yeah, it's been really fun, Aaron. Thank you for doing this. It's been...
Hi, thanks for... Honestly, thanks for spending the Friday night in lockdown with me and kind of chatting about old times and asking questions and stuff. It's been really nice.
It's been really fun.
Well, I appreciate you all coming, and you know, obviously you're obviously big fans if you've kind of like done this, so I really appreciate all the support back then and all the support you still give now, even though we're, you know, just 8 people doing whatever, but you know, it's lovely to have the support here still, and yeah, I really appreciate it.
No worries, thanks for doing it. Take care, everyone.
Have a lovely weekend.
Thank you.
Bye.
Later. Bye. Bye, guys.